So, friends, welcome to our distinguished lecture series talk today. It's by a dear friend, Anurag Saxena ji, but he's not just a dear friend, he's one of the smartest people I know, and also a lot of fun to be with. There's never a dull moment, you know, you can spend hours, and you know, there's so many things to talk about. But you know, behind the facade of someone who's not just smart and happy-go-lucky, there is a very determined individual, okay, who has understood the way the world works and wants to make a difference, and a positive difference, I would say. Now, I'll just introduce his project in a moment, but a few words about him. He's a chartered accountant, he's an MBA from an IIM in India, and he's had a very distinguished career before he went full time to do things that are important to him. Of course, he's an investor, so he spends, I suppose, a fraction of his time to make sure that everything is good in terms of his own, situation. He's Singapore-based, and he's in a way now, Anurag, you don't have to hear all this, but he's an international celebrity. He has appeared on the, you know, on BBC. He's published in Washington Post, in the Times. He's been all over the world virtually and really to bring this cause forward, you know. I'll talk about the cause in a moment. And what is more interesting to me, as not just as an academic, but as somebody who studies narrative, is that Anurag ji is able convince people on all sides of the ideological and political spectrum about the justness of his cause. Now, this speaks not just about the cause, because there are many causes which are just, but it also speaks about his finesse in the way he presents his cause. Now, he will speak about his cause, but I will only mention a few broad things. You know, many years ago, when I was still a student in the United States, I happened to go to one of the top museums in America. And I paused before a beautiful image of a Ganesha, you know, and I saw that the kumkum and the turmeric on the idol were fresh. By fresh, I mean, you know, if you touched them, you know, they would come off. That means they were a few weeks or a few months old. And there was somebody taking, you know, us around on a tour. If you go to, if you go to one of these museums, even the Smithsonian, there are these tours. So you can sign up for a tour. See, 11 o'clock, there's a tour of the Indian, exhibits. And I asked the lady, I said, you know, this image has been freshly worshipped. And she said, really? She said, how do you know that? I said, look at the marks on it, you know. It's not like this image was worshipped like 200 years ago. No, the marks are reasonably fresh. And of course, I can't touch it. But, and then it said, acquired by the museum, blah, 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 from Sotheby's or some house, some auction house, whatever. And that acquisition date was just a few months prior. So what got me thinking is, how was an image worshipped just a few months ago, now in a museum in the, you know, what was the process? And then, you know, as one talked to people, one began to realize there's a huge nexus. There's several abandoned temples in India. Just Tamil Nadu has almost 30,000 temples, you know, which are in a very sad state. Some of these temples are under the local archaeological survey or the national ASI or several other bodies. And not just Tamil Nadu, all over India. You go to Orchha, which is under the Madhya Pradesh Archaeological Survey. People are playing cricket inside monuments. There are buffaloes near Shivalingas, and several monuments have been occupied, okay? Even in Delhi. So it's so easy, you know, to pick up a stone and you to pick up an image, to pick up some artifact, and there's a huge black market where these can be traded, even today, after so much awareness. And of course, as they say, the dash 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 hit the ceiling when a prominent RDer in the US, whose name we can say because I think he's still under investigation, Mr. Subhash Kapoor, I think, with links with the high and mighty of the land, was apprehended for antique thefts. Now, there are rules, there are laws all over. There are UNESCO conventions, and I'm sure Anuragji will brief us about them, which can protect, the trade in these artifacts. And yet, as we speak, artifacts are being stolen and shipped abroad. Okay. Now, Anuragji has had some tremendous successes, and you need the cooperation of several government agencies and the host country as well. And we've succeeded, and the PM himself has taken a lot of bringing our gods back home. And this is one cause in which left, right, center, everybody wants to stand for this. Okay. And Anuragji will again explain to us his methodology, his way of approaching this problem, which I think is really unique, and it's very important. And the other thing I wanted to say, just to flip the coin, to be the devil's advocate, so to speak, another experience, you go to the Art Institute in Chicago, or you go to a great museum like the Met, or even in England, you'll see a lot of Tibetan artifacts, okay? And there are places where an entire shrine has been reconstructed. And of course, for Egypt, this has been done almost pervasively in the Pergamon, in Berlin, in all kinds of museums. You'll have a whole pyramid or the interior of a burial chamber reconstructed. Why am I playing the devil's advocate? I'm saying this because there are civilizations and cultures which are, totally, utterly destroyed. So at least there's a place where they have been kept for the people of the world to see, So that's the other side of the coin, that ultimately this is the heritage of humanity. I'm not a chauvinist. There is just one human culture, and we are all custodians of it. Okay, so this is the other side of it, that rather than it being completely wasted and never found, perhaps if there is a stable place where it's kept for the time being, even the Elgin marbles, there's a struggle to return them to Athens. I'm sure Anuragji will bring up all these aspects. And finally, the topic, decolonization. Dharampalji used to famously say, quoting Gandhiji, in fact, that decolonization is a lengthy process, because there is a thing called the half-life of colonization. And we have really reached that. 75, India 75, I think it's a really, really important cusp for us. Because if you consider colonization in the last phase, 150 years of British rule, it's like a toxin inside a civilization's body, And the usvo zeher nikalte nikalte, there's a half-life. So half of it we are reaching, 75 years. And now is the time to aggressively, I think, get back, what is ours. Because decolonization happens in the mind first, and then physically, as he said, one object at a time, you can retrieve your heritage. And for me, Anuragji is a hero, because without government backing, he and friends, Mr. Kumar, they started the India Pride Project. He'll tell you about that. These people, they're not sarkari damads, like us. They are not paid by the state or by an NGO, let alone by some billionaire sitting somewhere trying to disrupt through remote control, societies and economies somewhere else. No, these people are self-motivated, and that's what makes them effective and nimble, in today's world. So with those words, I take great pride and pleasure in welcoming Anuragji. All yours.
Well, Makran ji, it is such a pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for everybody that's joined in. Clearly each of us could have been elsewhere, and each of you have taken a decision to be here instead. So I'd really like to thank you. Apart from whatever I need to say today, I'm really, really happy that Emily has joined us. Emily works with a dear colleague of mine, Alex Herman, with the Institute of Art and Law in London, and they are now really trying to understand the idea of understand the perspective of decolonization or heritage. Hi, Emily, good to see you here. you know, so it's very important. I think the collective job.
Welcome, Ms. Gul. Thank you for joining us. Welcome.
Thank you. Sorry, I was struggling to unmute myself. Thank you. It's very good to be here. And Alex sends his apologies, but it's kind of in the middle of the night for him, so I'm sure he'll catch up on the video.
Yeah. In fact, I'll make sure he views it, and then I'll make sure we all get on a call again for the report you guys are making for the British government.
Great. So, thank you.
There is a follow-up to this. There's a reason we are all here. But yeah, what I'd like us to do really is focus a lot on the interactive conversation that I'd like to have after the presentation. And I'd like, you know, exactly the direction you went in, Makranji, for Emily or for anyone who watches this video later to understand the perspective, the thoughts, the feelings, the hurt, the angst of a civilization that has been plundered, that has been stolen. And I think that's very important in what we're trying to do. So thank you all for having me here. I am going to try getting my presentation up. Do let me know if you can see a PowerPoint on your screens. If anyone can just confirm they can see the PowerPoint on your screens, please.
Yes.
Okay. So really the format I'd like for today is to spend 20 or 25 minutes talking through the idea of decolonization and why the decolonization through objects is important. Now, over the years, India Pride Project or the whole idea of restitution has grown large enough to need multiple conversations like these. So I'm happy to answer questions, you know, jot down your thoughts after the limited presentation I'm going to make. Now, again, I am aware that I'm talking, you know, pretty much everyone on this call is more astute, more qualified, has more cerebral capacity than I do. All of you are PhDs and what have you. So I'm going to, you know, I'm going to just talk about three or four stories. Instead of intellectualizing the whole idea of what we do. The first story is of this dapper gentleman here, Lord William Bentinck, the Governor General, you know, around the time we were colonized very early on. Now, true to the story of any colonization, his job was to essentially enrich the coffers of the Crown of England, and he did a fairly good job with that. Ritika ji, can you confirm that what you see is full screen for everyone or in a corner?
Yes, please, sir.
Okay, perfect. Now, what this gentleman tried, and he was quite jugadu and innovative for his own time, when he wasn't hitting his revenue targets, he did what every self-respecting colonizer would do. He tried to sell off the Taj Mahal. And I'd like you guys to go and check out the historical records of the British themselves. But guess what? When he wasn't able to successfully sell off the Taj Mahal, he moved a few miles west to the Agra Fort and actually sold off all the marble from the Agra Fort, which is why now you see red sandstone where marble existed. And he melted the great gun, which was the biggest cannon of its time across the world. So there was this thing called the great gun. He melted it and sold off, you know, the iron and copper and whatever he got from it. And that for me summarizes the story of colonization, right? Which is, you had people coming in, taking our lives, taking our resources and taking our heritage. And this is not unique to the UK as an aggressor. This is not unique to India as a victim. This was a totally acceptable, legit global phenomena till not very long back. Now, the whole idea of India Pride Project is very simply this. You cannot give our lives back. You cannot give our resources back. The least you can do as a gesture of goodwill, as a gesture of atoning for the sins of your forefathers, is to give back the heritage that you took from us. Now, again, Makranji, because he's a friend, he knows I'm quite a filmy kind of a guy, as we call it in India. And I'm going to talk to you about, you know, Indiana Jones and Robert Langdon and these archetypes and what they have meant in terms of the way the West looks at, you know, please notice they're all white and they're all men. And there's a reason they're all white and they're all men, right? Because at some deeper psychological level, whenever you need to legitimize something that is otherwise, that would otherwise be considered illegit. You know, if I walked into your home and took your pots and pans away or stole your TV or your phone, there'd be no question that I was doing something that was fundamentally immoral, legality aside. But when you make a swashbuckling Harrison Ford, do it with style, it suddenly becomes legit, right? What India Pride Project is fighting is not just the research, not just the provenance mapping, not just the documentation, but we are fighting busting of these archetypes that have been normalized and legitimized over the ages, right? Let's see where these archetypes end up getting legitimized. You know, the whole idea that somebody can waltz into your civilization and take whatever they feel like. Look at Egypt, look at China, look at India. All of us talk about history in terms of thousands of years, perhaps more. A lot of the aggression that happens, unfortunately, and very rationally so, happens from much younger nations that have histories of 200, 400, 500 or 1,000 years. It is their only way, again, I'm talking about it from a deep psychological subconscious point of view. It is the, you know, I mean, if you're sitting in the US today, you know, you have an innovative culture, you know, you have the crispiest of French fries, you have, the grandest of houses, spaceships, what have you. The one thing you don't have today is a sense of history, is a sense of continuity, which is exactly why you tend to seek it or plunder it or buy it from wherever it exists. But is this just a piece, you know, are these objects just objects or something more? You look at deep ancient Mongolian culture, a lot of Northwest Africa as an example. The picture on your left is what's called a gyayang or a totem pole. And African tribes believe that that piece of wood has the collective memories and souls of every tribal ancestor that came and went before, right? That piece of wood or many pieces of wood are the only connection they believe, you could call it a matter of belief, a matter of faith, what have you, with their ancestors, with anyone that came before them, right? The picture on the right, which we're all familiar with, the Ganesha that Makaranji talked about, we all know what space it plays in our, you know, in our collective consciousness, in our collective faith, in a country like India. When these objects are taken away from their, from their context, you're actually taking away every non-tangible aspect that came with the object. And that is where the problem lies. You're decontextualizing an object and making it a showpiece, which is multiple levels of an affront, right? Not just do you make it a showpiece, you sell us replicas, sometimes, you know, cheap plastic replicas. I mean, you know, this is insult over injury, where you take something that was ours, you forcefully display it in your museums. I mean, these were things that were made for certain communities with a certain objective in mind. Going back to Makaranji's questions that, hey, aren't they better taken care of elsewhere, temperature controlled environment and security and what have you. And guess what? That's not what these objects were meant for. I mean, it is, it's akin to Makaranji coming to me and saying, hey, Anurag, you're really not a great son. You don't spend enough time with your mother. You don't take her to the doctor often. You're not there for her. I'm more prosperous than you, so I'm going to kidnap your mother under the promise that I will take care of her. That's something that's not going to fly. It's also not going to fly because, you know, for a lot of communities, these objects are as important as their mothers, their families, what have you. You know, they have names, they have linkages with family histories. You will see, a shroud of Turin is not a piece of cloth. I get it when Christopher Hitchens or whoever says that, hey, that's just a piece of cloth. But for many, many, many people, it is really a part of a person that is connected to them. And that's the context that gets lost when these faith objects move from the East to the West. Right. In terms of loss of context, and I'm going to be a little provocative here, borderline rude, but somebody's got to say it. What do you say or how do you respond to a recurrent failure to resist an impulse to steal, right? To the psychological, perhaps sometimes the psychosomatic effects of the tension you feel when you're in a situation of aggression, not a victim, but even an aggressor, right? What do you talk about, antisocial disorders, manic episodes that come along with being an aggressor? Fundamentally, when your weakness is the need to steal, right? The DSM-5 criteria, these are the DSM-5 criteria for kleptomania. We're talking about collective kleptomania here that existed in the past, perhaps in a much more diluted form today. Those of you who are interested in learning more about this, the American Psychiatric Association publishes these, revises them every 5 years. And it's a fascinating study on what it means at an individual level, which is how psychology or psychiatry is supposed to work, but also at a collective level, right? So the question is, what happens when cognitive dissonance is normalized? Right? Now, I know I am engaging in some kind of fallacy here. Haters will say that, hey, listen, a nation or a foreign nation or a foreign government or a foreign people that insist on living with stolen heritage from the past isn't as extreme as, people fawning over Hitler, let's say. Point taken on the sense of proportion. What we still cannot ignore is that collectively, there is some element of cognitive dissonance that Western nations are having to deal with, where on one hand, they say that, hey, listen, we're great guys, we're ethically and morally centered, we have an internal compass, et cetera, et cetera. We are a law-abiding society. But on the other hand, you're having to live with what your grandfather stole from mine. That cognitive dissonance, when amplified over thousands and millions of people over centuries, should lead to some kind of an imbalance or disequilibrium in society, which I see manifesting itself in many ways. Right. There's a lot of work done on the body, brain, and mind equilibrium. I'm not going to get into that, but when communities, when nations display collective signs of what would be considered a trait or a disease at an individual level, that is something really, really, really worrisome. And I think that's what has happened with the Western society normalizing the act of stealing what was never theirs. For those who are interested on these aspects, Dr. Andrew Huberman does a lot of work on this at an individual level and then at a group think level, but I'm not going to get into that. The point I'm making here is we as a nation, and many nations, you have about a dozen nations that are now saying something which is very basic and very simple. It's a line which my dear friend Padma Awardee Ananda Shankar Jayant had given me, that history belongs to its geography. It's a very simple, logical, rational, powerful thought that we're only now seeing emerging. And I really do believe we've hit our Rosa Parks moment over the last 5 years or 10 years, where a bunch of nations are demanding that history belongs to its geography. A bunch of nations are now saying yes, it does, and a bunch of former colonizers are saying yes, it does. Right now, to deal with collective cognitive dissonance, to change the narrative, to change people's minds is not easy. It needs a lot of therapy. It needs a lot of correction of evaluative beliefs, correction of lenses with which people view the same action, right? When we set up India Pride Project, the one thing we realized was there were a whole bunch of researchers before us that were doing the academic part of the job. So starting in the 70s, we've had researchers from India doing the documentation, the provenance mapping, you know, and really, really robust work on proving that, hey, here was a murti, here was an object, let's prove that this was here, you know, the UNESCO convention that Makaranji talked about, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. There was a lot of effort on the left brain side for a good, you know, 40 years. However, history wasn't coming back to its geography. Why wasn't it coming back to its geography? Because there was no right brain effort that was involved. And that's where India Pride Project came in. And that's what our objective was. And look, I'll be very honest, a lot of people who were doing the, you know, the technical work, the research work, etc., don't like us for that, which is, you know, so they look at it as a research problem, not a results problem. They look at it as something to outrage on, not something to get outputs on. And that's, you know, the research to results leap is really where IPP came in and said, hey, listen, we have to be about changing what is normal. We have to be about ending political polarization on this issue. We have to be about building acceptability, et cetera, et cetera. So what did we do? A bunch of things. Our team in the UK, led by, you know, this amazing guy, Pritesh Patel, walks into V&A, walks into British Museum, holds these little, speech bubbles and takes these pictures, especially of faith objects that have been stolen from India. What are we doing here? We are visualizing and animating the plight felt by these objects. For those of you who are in the UK, especially within the NRI of the Indian community, you remember this having gone crazy viral, right? And it helped build amazing amount of traction, especially in 43 constituencies, where the South Asian diaspora was a huge voting block. The British Museum, shortly after this, you know, the British Museum actually tweeted, you know, this picture of the Vishnu saying that, hey, this is, you know, this is from India, et cetera, et cetera. Look what happens after that. Hundreds and thousands of responses, which are essentially calling out the lack of morality of the British Museum taking pride in something that was stolen. Right? Crazy amount. And might I tell you, after that day till today, the British Museum hasn't proudly tweeted about any faith objects they've taken from India. As Makaranji mentioned, you know, I'm really proud about the fact that we have people across the political spectrum who support this, even domestically within India. We have a whole bunch of people tweeting, writing to the British Museum, etc. And I'm highlighting this tweet, right? Even people that don't know how thieves is spelled is calling the British Museum thieves. And I think we have to be, you know, if you've dealt with anybody that has that is dealing with disorder, you know, intervention includes a stage where you call out what that disease is. And people who don't even know how thieves is spelled is calling out that disease, right? Because of the effort on the Parthenon marbles, with what's happening with Ghana, et cetera, et cetera, the British Museum had to come out with a statement which said, not everything was looted. Now let that sink in. We're talking of a 92-year-old effort to take back the Parthenon marbles. And the British Museum had never felt the need to engage with anybody at all. But here we sit today, with them actually issuing a statement, and let the weight of the sink in. Imagine what it takes for a former colony to say, not everything was looted. Right? That's a huge milestone for all of us collectively. Right? You know, we come from we come from an era with where, you know, the sun was never supposed to set on the empire and all of that, and then it finally set, etc., etc. Now, as far as this particular cause goes, we're seeing a bit of a sunrise of our own, right? Over the last 5 or 6 years, we've had 5 or actually 6 now countries giving back our heritage to our honorable prime minister. As Makranji says, you know, a lot of people take credit for all the work that the government is doing. You know, we can only request, we can only, you know, we can be advocates for the cause, we can push it. But at the end of the day, the government has to decide that this is something they prioritize. And I'm personally ecstatic and honored that the current dispensation in India is taking this as a cause they prioritize. You know, if you can just see the numbers here. In the first 65 years of India's independence, a total of 13 objects came back to India. That's 13 objects every, you know, over 65 years. That's roughly one object every 5 years. In the last 5 or 6 years, we've had 232 objects offered back to us. Think of that as a spike. Where we had one object every 5 years, we're talking of 236. Huge spike. That comes only when a lot of crazy factors come in together. There's a narrative that's changing across the world. There's an Indian government that is willing to be a little more assertive. Our diplomatic effort is changing. There's a bunch of middle-aged guys like me who are saying that, hey, listen, let's go out there, make it happen. You know, so I think a lot of, I mean, the, you know, honestly, the only thing I can ascribe this to is destiny or timing or whatever it is. As much as Makranji or anybody else would say that, hey, this is Anurag. No, this is not Anurag. If anything, this is the government. If anything, it is the bunch of amazing volunteers that I'm blessed to have, and a sense of timing, right? But more importantly, more than these numbers, here is why we do this. Here is a picture of the temple the Nataraja was stolen from. Here is how the temple looks like when the Nataraja actually comes back. More than the stone and the picture and what have you, look at what it does to the community. On the left, you know, you have shrubs and moss and a dog walking around. On the right, you have a whole community coming out to celebrate the return of the person, you know. And again, I'm saying person. It is not an object. It is not a murti. It is definitely not an idol or a statue, right? The Nataraja was something that they associated with. When that came back, it energizes society as a whole. And that's what we're doing here, right? Now, let's go back. Let's go back to Indiana Jones and the narrative that Makaranji was talking about. Was Indiana Jones a hero or was he a villain? And Alex, you know, while I was preparing for this, Alex actually sent me a little tweet saying the evolution in the morality of Indiana Jones, where between 1981, his first movie, and 1989, his third film. So in the first film, Indiana Jones says, hey, this belongs to a museum. And progressively, 2 films later, he says that, hey, listen, this belongs in situ. And it's a good evolution for Indiana Jones to have gone through. However, the question still remains that was Indiana Jones a hero or was he Spielberg's con, right? Just because Hollywood had a superior ability, you know, to fund their narrative better, for better special effects, you know, better editors, cinematographers, what have you, better distribution networks across the world. Were they able to sell their idea of an aggressor that waltzes in and takes whatever he feels like? And that's the question we're here to answer today. Right? We really need to sit down and question not just the dead bodies, the resources, but the heritage that the empire was founded on and grew on, right? And it's time for us to forcefully have that conversation today. For those of you who watched Black Panther, I'm sure you remember Killmonger. Killmonger's turn to the dark side happens when he sees heritage from his community or nation or civilization stolen and put away in a museum. The conversation is changing. You have the UK Labour leader, Jeremy Corbyn, who promises to return Parthenon marbles if elected PM. The fact that restitutions are becoming a mainstream conversation is important. You have Emmanuel Macron, who's already started the process and set up the committee to return objects back to Benin and Ghana and what have you. You realize a narrative is changing when Hollywood latches on, right? So you have, this is a press conference for Monuments Men, where Matt Damon and George Clooney actually lent weight to the idea that, history belongs to its geography. And if you think Matt Damon and George Clooney aren't sexy enough for your narrative, then here's the only human being that is, Bill Murray, right? So Bill, it's amazing that this conversation is happening today, right? Now I'm going to end in a minute. What does it mean to us in India? So we've talked about the idea of colonization. We've talked about the idea of taking what was ours. We've talked about what it means in terms of collective psychology when disorders are normalized, whether it's kleptomania, whether it's cognitive dissonance, whatever have you. And obviously, if a particular behavior is normalized within a community, it is very tough to have a conversation. And therefore, the resistance takes a lot of effort. Should we as Indians be happy that our Indian flag is being, put up on the Burj in Dubai and Empire State Building and what have you? And the Alps as it happened last year, right? Or is there something else we need to do to reclaim? Are there any alternative stories that exist, right? One of the most common pushbacks I have is, hey, listen, why are you worried about heritage? India has already taken over UK in terms of, being the fifth largest economy in the world. We're going to be 5 trillion. Our diplomatic efforts are more assertive today. India is putting up a really brave front. I mean, why are you stuck in the past, right? And here's my response to them. We started with William Bentinck. I'm going to end with Karpuri Thakurji. True blue son of the soil. For those of you who don't have the historical context, he was the first chief minister of Bihar that was not upper caste. For those of you who remember or understand the whole idea of Uchi Jati and Nichi Jati. He was the first, in fact, a lot of the leaders you see in Bihar today, whether it is Nitish Kumar or Lalu or Yadavji or whoever, were all interns and students under Karpuri Thakurji. He fought for the pride of the disenfranchised. He died penniless, but having won a huge, huge battle that wasn't won for centuries. What happened in the late 70s when his father died? He was a sitting chief minister. When his father died, he went back to his village. Now, for those of you who, just for context, he comes from, again, when we're talking of the caste system, your role in society or your place in society was dictated by your vocation. Now, the lineage he came from were essentially Babas, what were called Hajam in the older days. When his father died, he went back to the village for the last rites and all of that. His father died of pneumonia because they couldn't afford a house with a pakka roof. And when it rained, the cold essentially took his father's life away. When he went back and wanted to do the last rites, the Thakurs or the upper caste of the village actually came to him and said, "Ki dekho, ab aaya oot pahar ke niche." Right? So now you see that you are dependent on us, right? And said a line which was played out in the media verbatim, which said ki aap chief minister Patne mein hoge, yahan to aap hajam ho, right? You might be a chief minister in Patna, but here you're still a Baba, right? And that is what happens in any oppressor victim scenario. As India tries to claim its place in the world, the only thing we need to focus on right now is to stop people from telling us ki bas yahan to tum hajam ho, right? You're not welcome here because guess what? little brown boy. You might be whoever you think you are. You might be taking our jobs away, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, but you're not welcome here. The only response to that sort of unhealthy aggression is, you know, you respond to a bully in only one language. And that's, I hope, you know, reclaiming our heritage back is our way of saying that, hey, listen, the last remnant of colonization that you took from us, we will ensure that we bring it back. Bringing back our symbols is how we reclaim our civilization. And that's why this is important to us. With that, I'd really thank you all for taking the time off this afternoon. You have my name, you know, I'm available on social media. Makaranji has my connects. More than happy to answer questions now or in the future. What I would really request from each of you is, you know, do spread the word around. Use your good offices, use your WhatsApp groups, what have you, and explain the story to people. Explain why India cannot claim its place till symbols of oppression still exist. This holds true for individuals. You know, you might be trying to get out of an abusive relationship. You might be trying to get out of a boss that, you know, get away from a boss that doesn't care. You might be stuck with narcissist friends, what have you. We need to understand that we are dealing with what very clearly was abuse, was narcissism, was unacceptable. And that happens, you know, getting out of it, abusing it only happens when you reverse the physical memories of that abuse, which is exactly why I'd like each of you to join our effort and help in whichever way you can. With that, back to you, Makaranji.
Thank you so much. That was very engrossing, riveting, as always. And it also made me think, because you brought in some new dimensions to this struggle. And I thought it was interesting how you, you know, tried to relate this history of spoilage and, you know, should I say loot, if I'm being not very polite, with the daily mental abuse and trauma that we continue to suffer today because of abusive relationships. I think this adds psychological dimension and certainly helps us, even if we are not so engaged in the retrieval of stolen artifacts, it helps us engage and relate to it as a case of an archetypal abuse on a huge scale. You know, the conquest of civilizations is also a form of an abusive relationship. And you mentioned Karpuri Thakur. I thought that was also a very interesting way to connect, you know, the kind of struggles that we undergo in India, even today. These are life struggles with a deeper history, with a longer history of colonialism. And it also struck me how, you know, let's also give the devil its due, as it were. It's easier to retrieve objects from Western museums because there are rules and laws, but there are many objects in other parts of the world. If you go to the Topkapi Museum in Istanbul, you will see artifacts from all over the world, including what was purportedly Jesus's staff or Moses's staff or Jesus's bowl. Or artifacts from the entire region that the Ottomans had conquered and ruled. And there's not a single squeak about, you know, getting some of those back. And there are some from India there as well, by the way. So the point I'm making is that the rights of conquest, so to speak, were recognized the world over. And colonialism was obviously fueled by the greed, you know, of the European powers. It was easy plunder, and it was legitimated by a variety of ideologies, including religious ideologies. You know, the plunder and destruction of South America was propped up by religious ideologies, by and large, and British colonialism was propped up by secular ideologies of reform and the white man's burden, liberalism, rights of man, and so forth. So these were some of the questions, I mean, thoughts that went through my mind, that I think there is a partnership here that is also possible, as is demonstrated with Emily G joining us. I think there's a greater scope today for restoration or restitution, because common codes of conduct and civilized behavior have emerged. But there are parts of the world where these codes somehow don't seem to extend, you know, and so we have to engage with that part of our, you know, phase of colonialism, which we don't want to talk about even, you know. So, and the plunder of the world, the destruction of monuments is going on even today. Bamiyan Buddhas is in our living memory. And ISIS, we've seen what happened when they overran parts of, you know, the Levant and Syria, and, you know, lots of artifacts were destroyed and sold. So it's a much deeper, and even today in Kashmir, there are many temples which are destroyed, you know, etc. So this is a living problem. It's not just an East versus West problem. It's a much more complex problem. And we have to also earn the right, you know, to safeguard our own traditions. And I love the point about, you know, this Nataraja coming back, the presence of the deity. This is profound, because in our legal system, the deity is a living person, okay? Though sometimes he's treated or she's treated as a minor. So you have to litigate on behalf of a minor because they can't speak up for themselves. And our friend Sai Deepak and all has written, you know, extensively about this, how we have to litigate on behalf of the deities, because once they have pran pratishthapana, they are living entities, they have lands, they have titles, they have rights and so forth. So I think that, the, you know, fascinating. And I just wanted to add a footnote about the sale of Taj, you know. Part of it is apocryphal. There's a wonderful article by Sir Percival Spear. It was published in 1949, if I'm not mistaken. Let me see if I can pull it up, because I'd saved it earlier. And it was published in the Journal of the Royal Asiatic Society. And it ends with this conclusion. He provided, he says, the conclusion seems unwarranted that while Bentinck did in fact order the sale of some marble in a Mughal bathroom in the Agra fort, the Taj story was an imaginative addition by his military critics. And I might say that what's really happening today is there's a lot of myth making around these things, you know. In fact, I was reading about this when you mentioned the Taj, and somebody says the British sold the Taj for 1.5 lakhs to some Lakshmi Das Seth, you know, and there's a story that you know, that the local people, you know, somehow rallied Seth Lakshmi Chand, Seth Lakshmi Chand of Mathura, for 1.5 lakhs, and the local artisans. You know, so there are a lot of Marxist myths also around it, because what they wanted to show is these artisans whom Shah Jahan patronized supposedly, and they lived in a colony near the Taj, they rose in arms, you know, in a Hindu-Muslim resistance to this purported sale. So, you see, we have to be very careful. And I, for one, by the way, I respect myths, because in India, we are a land of myths. But there are different kinds of truths. There is a historical truth which needs a particular kind of evidence and a particular kind of documentation. And then there is a poetic truth, you know, and then there's an ideological truth. So I think the point is well taken, that the British shook the pagoda tree and all the coins that dropped. And I think one of the best ways, the best example, is start with William Dalrymple's opening statement, you know, where he talks about this castle in Wales, which has the hugest plunder from India, you know, and you can go and see it today. You can see it. And that is the place where what Clive alone took is there. So please look at that. That's a better evidence, because those artifacts are there and there's a whole history of that. But these other stories are somewhat apocryphal. And we have to be careful when we peddle them, because they sometimes may injure our cause. Okay, having said that, I'm throwing this open. And one person asks, are we going to get a certificate of participation? I don't know who's asked this, but this is not what we normally do, whoever the person is, because we are not a degree awarding institute, and I don't know why you need these certificates, but frankly, this is not what we normally do, and this is a webinar, it's not a proper seminar. Okay, are there any other questions? Somebody said, let me see here if I can...
While we wait for questions, can I just make a quick couple of responses?
Please do.
So this is my hypothesis. So, you know, you mentioned whether these religious conquests are there, you know, were these for other reasons, et cetera, et cetera. There were some conquests that were purely, the Crusades as an example, were purely religious in nature. Colonization, on the other hand, it's fascinating. When Christopher Columbus wanted the queen to, this was a person in Spain, to fund the expedition, in the letter, which is, you know, you can get a copy of it on the PDF online, he mentions the word gold 17 times, gold or wealth. And the word Lord and God is mentioned just once, right? So the myth around Christopher Columbus is that, listen, he wanted to spread the word of God, and which is why he set out and blah, blah, blah. But that wasn't what his, let's say, his budget proposal, if I may, actually said. So I'm tilted to assume that colonization, which is separate from the Crusades, was only about wealth. Taking away what was yours, it could be your dignity, it could be your heritage, it could be whatever it is, was a tool of oppression. What we would today call gaslighting, as an example, in individual relationship kind of circumstances. So, that's the kind of view I have of these things. If it is gaslighting, you know, how do we respond, et cetera, et cetera. I was watching David Letterman's, I'm forgetting what it's called, but there's this new show on Netflix where they bring in one guest for a full hour. And this was an episode with Robert Downey Jr. This is going back into saying, Kecha, what do we do about Turkey? What do we do about nations that might not have a well-established code of conduct or law of the land? And Robert Downey Jr. said two words which really stuck with me. So David Letterman asked him that, look, you've had a history of substance abuse, you've run away from rehab, you've gone back multiple times into your old ways, you've been self-destructive, et cetera, et cetera. So how come you've been sober for a decade? And he just said, ultimatums work. That's it. So sometimes it is just about the gorilla going and sitting wherever the heck he knows it, his right is. And that's about it.
No, perfect. See, we are on the same page. No question. And the show, I think, of David Letterman's is my next guest needs no introduction, you know. Yes, I think that's what his show is called. Listen, speaking of the media, I love the way you brought in Indiana Jones and all that. But don't forget Lara Croft and the Tomb Raider. So, you see, it's not just men. See, women are also Tomb Raiders. And it's sad that that empowering women through images of people, you know, who are sort of ball busting, you know, out there, ladies, is somehow also tied up with plundering, you know, the passive orient, you know, which is a kind of new orientalism. In other words, that how do you prove your prowess? You prove your prowess by going to countries. And you see, after all, Indiana Jones was America's answer to some extent to James Bond, you know, because it was that kind of a swashbuckling. And of course, he's a professor too, or whatever, anthropologist to boot. So these are very deep. And, you know, Temple of Doom was, for me, my goodness, you know, Amrish Puri also playing this sinister creature. So what I'm simply saying is the world of today is far more complicated, and we have to seek collaborations and partnerships from a variety of actors. And yep. I think you're absolutely right that name and shame is the name of the game. And speaking of museums, think about, your great museum in Singapore, the Museum of Asian Civilizations. There have been artifacts there that have a dubious provenance, manner in which they were acquired. They're very beautifully displayed there. So all I'm saying is, once you, like you guys have done, once you highlight how this whole nexus operates, every other museum is going to be 100 times more careful, you know, to try and acquire these objects through these clandestine and the gray market, as it were, and put them on display. They're all going to, in fact, I'll tell you before we go to questions, you know, I have a friend who's a collector, okay? And he's a very respected man. And he actually loaned out several of his collection to the, to the Chhatrapati Shivaji Sangrahalaya in Mumbai, okay? Mm-hmm. It's a very respectable museum, the best in Mumbai, you would say. And because of all this, the museum returned all his stuff. Okay, he had given it free, okay? And they returned it. Prince of Wales Museum, it used to be called. It's a very, very famous museum in a beautiful building. They said, you know, sir, please get each of these objects certified. And only when we know how you acquired them and they're all properly certified as legit, will we take them back. So, you know, my friend had to go through so much red tape, but that's worth it. It's the same thing that people who have FCRA today go through. They have to prove to the government that they're not getting funds for abroad for whatever nefarious purposes in order to continue. So I'm saying whatever has happened in the last 10, 20 years has had a salutary effect, you see, and for, you know, for the acquisition of Indian artifacts, right? And good. So here I have a few questions already coming in. So one of the questions is, and in fact, I'll take two of them. One is from Professor Madhav Hada. And he said that, you know what, they didn't take all these objects just for loot, but they took them also for curiosity. See, jigyasa aur samjhane ke liye bhi le gaye. क्या आप ऐसे लोगों की पहचान अलग से करेंगे? So that was one question, that people who took objects for study, for curiosity, okay, not only for loot and plunder, like Darwin took things from all over Gallip, you know, those Pagos Islands, and you know, he needed the fossils or whatever. You can say it's plunder, you know, history belongs to geography. In this case, you might say paleontology or fossil study belongs to geography, but he took them to England, back home. He studied them, he arranged them. So now here's another question from an art historian herself. She says, I'm glad Anurag ji is taking up this critical issue. And she says something very important, I think. Not having original artifacts to refer to hinders even today the study of whole disciplines like Mughal paintings, where either the manuscripts are collected in museums or they're torn into individual folios and dispersed in private collections. So I think this second question almost answers the first one, that, you know, if you believe that a civilization has some sort of primary right to study itself, and, you know, the ethic has some kind of primacy over the emic, then you want these artifacts to be available right where they belong, you know. And I think now, once again, we must have digital copies made so that, you know, the world is one type of thing also prevails. Now, let me also ask a couple of more questions, then you can answer. Then they say that, she adds, there are numerous manuscripts which still have notes on their folio stating that they were looted in this or that year when the library of this or that Indian ruler was looted and burnt. So these artifacts themselves contain the proof of their pilferage or gaslighting, okay? Then here's it's a wonderful follow-up question. She says, the British hate and blame Hitler for the same crime of looting their heritage and oil paintings, which they did to India and other Asian and African countries. Oh, absolutely. I mean, there's a huge movement to retrieve the stolen paintings of the Nazis, you know, and the litigation around them still continues, you know, to date. So why shouldn't the same standards apply? And then someone says here another question. How do we address the issue of the child not taking care of her mother? Miserable condition of Arctic architecture and artifacts in India. Okay, so you can answer that and then we'll see if there's more.
Okay, sorry, I'm just... So I'm going to go in the chronological order of the questions. So Professor Hada, very interesting question on jigyasa or curiosity. Now, from our perspective, there need to have been two things when an object was taken. A, it needed to have, they needed to have consent. B, whoever gave consent should have had the permission to give that consent. That's it. It's really as simple as that. So consent is to say, hey, so I can see, for example, Professor Hada, you're wearing a dashing red stole or muffler around your neck, right? Now, if I were to really love that muffler, let's say I'm a researcher, I really want to see the tana bana or how the muffler was made, et cetera, et cetera. I have the right to have it under two circumstances. A, you give me consent to take the muffler. B, you have the right to give me that consent. Now that muffler cannot be Makaranji's and you've borrowed it and then you've given it to me, et cetera. Now, the problem we have is a lot of these objects that get taken away, A, they were taken without consent. B, these were public objects. They were made for certain communities, which means no individual or family had the right to give the consent in the first place. Now, if you look at a lot of faith objects, people who owned, controlled, or took care of those objects did it in their capacity as trustees, right? And again, I'm going back into the legality that Makaranji talked about. So there is a king, there is a kingdom. The king is only the caretaker of a particular temple. Now, unke jo vanshaj hain, you know, they don't have the right, they don't own that temple or what belongs in there. It's the idea of trusteeship, not ownership, which means they did not have the right to sell it or give it away in the first place because it wasn't meant for their individual pleasure. It wasn't meant to be bequeathed to them. So, and I believe we have to turn the whole idea of provenance on its head. And Emily, if you're listening to this part still, if we haven't lost you, we have to turn the whole idea of provenance around where it should be incumbent on the current owner to prove that they have consent and that consent was given by a person who had a right to give that consent versus the other way around where we have to prove that, hey, this is ours. Second, fascinating question from the art historian lady. I apologize, I didn't get your name, ma'am, about not having originals in India and that hinders the ability for us to research. Absolutely, you know, I from a legal perspective, I view it almost as an IP kind of an intellectual property issue for countries that have thousands of years old of a civilization. You know, what we would call different forms of kala in India, right? It could be sculpture, it could be painting, it could be, you know, textile, writing, scripts, form, you know, fonts, what have you. Each of these is an art form. Some of these art forms have linkage to faith. Some of them have linkage to history. Some of them have linkage to community. So there's a huge intersectionality between art forms and various other disciplines. Each of these pieces of art is relevant as a form of intellectual property, as something that that at some point somebody in India built using a particular set of tools, knowledge, understanding, what have you. And our inability to study and own that IP is a problem today. It genuinely is a problem today, both at a tangible IP level and an intangible IP level. I'm going to give you an example very simply. You know, this is a paradox that I can't imagine how somebody could consider this behavior normal. Back in the British Museum, you have Gallery 33 and 33A. Now, the gallery, you know, the gallery actually has a ring that Tipu Sultan wore, right? So there's a ring. A few feet away from that ring is a painting of the dead body of Tipu Sultan and British soldiers robbing away all the jewelry from the dead body. Right, and I'm just holding my head and thinking, oh my God, how can this level of cognitive dissonance be okay with you guys, where you're actually documenting the loot and are proudly displaying the loot and the documentation of that loot? I mean, you know, where I come from, you try and hide away evidence of loot, but you know, it is what it is. Third question on, you know, the British blaming Hitler and the efforts to recover Nazi art. Again, this for me is the same paradox of the cognitive dissonance that I keep talking about. I know I can't name it here, but Emily knows who I'm talking about, and Alex definitely knows who I'm talking about. But there is a huge, let's just be politically correct and call it a track two effort, led by a few powerful Jews in London, well, in the UK, and from the West Coast in the US, who are engaging in lobbying, engaging in legal efforts, and building narratives around recovering the art, recovering all the Jewish art looted by the Nazis. And I'd like to go back to what Professor Makranji was saying a while back. I think what we need from India, you know, there's a fascinating article in the Washington Post from a few years back. For those who like reading between the lines, the article is interesting because it was written by the Global Opinions editor. Now, the Global Opinions editor, Karen, as we all know, editors don't normally write articles. They commission certain people to write articles, and they edit it. Now, the two people that from India that this lady commissions are Barkha Dutt and Rana Yu. So the editor wrote a very interesting article comparing the efforts of India and China, how one is based on, let's just call them Gandhian principles of conversations, morality, et cetera, while, you know, the Chinese model is based on force and force and power and what have you. I genuinely believe that, you see, what India cannot do today with the UK or with anybody else is what they did with us 200 years back. That is not a sustainable model, right? We're talking of history. Every time power equations change, so I loot you today, you loot it back tomorrow, and then I loot you day after, and vice versa. This is, you know, the old parampara of khandani dushmani, which never goes away. What needs to happen now, and which is where IIAS kind of Institute of Art and Law kind of organizations come in, is, you know, we live in a world of ideas. We need to be able to collaborate and reframe the lens with which this is seen, at least at a thought leader level. And thought leaders almost always emanate primarily from academia, and then at some point it goes mainstream, then at some point people start caring about it, and then it becomes important enough for electoral votes, and then governments start bothering about it, etc. So I think what's really important is for us to, you know, is to come up with a fundamentally new model. You know, so we don't have brute force like the Chinese do. We don't have wealth like the Jews do. What we have, or what we have had historically, is the intellectual prowess, right? I think what we need to do is to institutionalize that, collaborate across cultures, across countries, whatever it is, build an appreciation that, hey, listen, here is a wrong that needs to be corrected, and through peer-reviewed journals, through articles, blah blah blah, push the idea out, and let the sapling grow into a new social norm. And I really hope that happens. The last question around, what do you do when a child doesn't take care of the mother? So I will tell you, sir, what Gandhiji told, I don't know who it was, probably Churchill. I'm pretty sure it was Churchill. So when Churchill said, hey, listen, you know, you are a huge country, how will you manage on your own, and blah, blah, blah. And we all know now there's enough evidence to prove how much of a, you know, again, here, you know, media, especially fiction media, you know, films, novels, etc., have done a great job of edifying churches, right? But we now know, based on historical record, how much of a racist he was and how much, you know, he pretty much had genocidal tendencies. I mean, the whole Bengal famine does not come to somebody of sound mind. So Gandhiji had told him that, look, India has a bunch of problems, but those are our problems, not yours. So I think we need to go out and start saying that more boldly. A whole bunch of nations are broken. That does not give other nations or other communities or other civilizations the right to poke their nose. None of us here are pontificating on the quality of council homes in England, or the opioid crisis in the US, or rampant extremism in the Middle East. None of us are forcibly pushing our point of view on solving those challenges. So I would say that, look, if, you know, of course, we are far from perfect. I mean, it's a long, long way to go. But that's our problem to deal with. It's not for somebody else to come and usurp our right to deal with problems that we need to deal with. I don't know if that answers your questions. I'm happy if you have follow-ups or other new questions, if they've come up.
Thank you. Thank you. I think, Anuragji, you answered these or responded to these issues and questions really well. I think that your idea of scaling up, you know, to make effective and heard a voice which is contrary to, you know, whatever the accepted and passive, you know, complicity of our own elites who are, you know, whatever you may call it, the spoilage was. I think that's very well taken. And also to fight with the weapons that you know how to handle, not to borrow other people's weapons, because then you might be inept at them. So we can't be like the like our own colonizers were, nor can we be like the Chinese. But of course, our own colonizers, the British certainly, were very good at narrative building. They were also very good at games, you know. British games are played all over the world. And cricket, as Ashish Nandi once said, was an Indian game accidentally invented by the British. Anyhow, now I just thought that on that note, I would invite Emily G to say a few words of how she looks at it, how she, you know, views not only your presentation, but this whole issue of trying to reclaim these objects. So Emily G, we want to hear from you. Do you think this is a kind of reactive, chauvinistic pushback, or do you think there's merit in this kind of endeavor?
Well, thank you, and thank you for inviting me to speak. Thank you, Anurag, for a very fascinating presentation, as always. I've heard you speak several times, and always very engaging, and so many sort of good stories to bring these issues to light. And I think that is a lot of the sort of key to this, I suppose, in the sense that you talked just in the last few minutes about the sort of methodology and the way in which India is trying to carry forward these issues and these questions through dialogue and understanding and communication and awareness generally. And I think that has increased very much over the last few years, and certainly in the work that we have done at the Institute of Art and Law, which you mentioned, we've been working for a project that the Arts Council in the UK has been involved in, by way of producing some guidance for UK museums on restitution and repatriation issues. And certainly in all of the conversations we've had, the key to sort of progress on these issues and to some kinds of resolutions, which we all appreciate, you know, are very difficult. There are sort of centuries of history to kind of work through. The key is very much communication and open dialogue and transparency. These institutions, which you know, have been housing these objects, sort of understanding more about their history and their provenance, such that, you know, these conversations can come from a sort of transparent point of view. So that's really the gist of what I have taken from this whole process. But yeah, some really interesting ideas for everyone on the call today, certainly. So thank you very much, Anna. I really enjoyed hearing what you had to say.
Thank you, Emily G. You know, going back to the question I raised in the beginning, Anurag G, I think that, you know, when I was sort of playing the devil's advocate, you know, we've got a variety of possible, re-engagements with these objects, you know. I think the best one is the one you showed, how the living presence of a, you know, purloined deity, you know, re-energizes a town or a locality. I think that, in a sense, even the word koil in Tamil actually means the home. You know, it's like if the deity has been kidnapped and must be restored to his or her home, and they live there, they're tended to by their devotees and priests, and they are a part of the, you know, living, what should I say, environment of that community. And to take them away is like spelling the kind of doom to that community, because the deity gives them a center, a locus, and it's not just physical, but as you said, psychological. And to uproot the deity would then almost be tantamount to a terrible atrocity, a psychic assault on that community. Okay, so returning the deity home in that sense, to that temple or that sacred precinct in which they belonged, is obviously, in a sense, the best option. Now look at the other things. Then the other option is to return them to a museum in India. You know, there are many deities who have been so uprooted, we don't know where they came from. And then the third is, if you just think about this carefully, I would rather personally that, you know, when I talked about Tibet, I deliberately, because here's a community that has lost a country, you know. So suppose I'm a Tibetan, I can't go to China, I'm not allowed to go to China, but I could go to Chicago, I could go to London, and I could see some of these objects. You know, ideally they should be in Dharamshala, but I'm just saying that, so it's better for these objects to be in museums where they're accessible. Like the British Museum is accessible to everyone, it's free. You can put a donation, they ask you to put in at least £5, but it's still free, than in somebody's private home, which I cannot access. Some rich person, you know, showing off this, whatever, stolen or dubiously acquired artifact in their own drawing room. In fact, I'll tell you a little story in a moment about this. So that's better to be in a public space than in a private home. And finally, it's better to be retrieved than completely destroyed, you know. There are idols that have been destroyed to an extent that there are heads in one place, arms in another place. You can't even glue it together. So rather, like the Bamiyan Buddha, somebody has offered to put them all back together. We now have technology, but it's a huge project and you need to be very safe. You need to have experts being safe to restore. So I'm saying, rather than it being completely destroyed, better that it's preserved somewhere. But here's the story, after which you have the last word, and perhaps you can even tell us about the charity to which you want us to send your honorarium. You know, if anybody else wishes to contribute, you can make a pitch for that and then we'll end. You know, there's a wonderful little short story by R.K. Narayan called Two Horses and a Goat. So it's about this American tourist who comes in a traveler to this remote village in Tamil Nadu, and you know, he runs out of gas, his station wagon runs out of gas, he gets out, and he sees this shepherd who doesn't know a word of English, with he's just got two goats, okay, he's very poor, and you spoke about spouses at the beginning. So this guy has also been kicked out of home in the morning, saying, you good for nothing, old man, you know, go and earn a bit of money, we have nothing at home. So as usual, he's out there and, you know, dreaming of some windfall, which will change his fortunes, at least to the extent that he'll have a warm supper when he goes back home. And here's this American tourist who starts chatting him up. And we don't know this. I mean, he doesn't know it, rather we know it. the American wants to buy a statue, you know, which belongs to the village. It's right there. If you go to any Tamil Nadu village, there are these fierce deities at the edge of a village, which is supposed to protect the village. So what's happening is there are these, there's a stat, these two horses, you know, which belong to the village, that the village's heritage, and the American is negotiating a price with this guy because he thinks that he owns that statue because he's sleeping under that shade, the canopy, and they come to some kind of deal. So he says, yes, 200 rupees, you know, and then this guy goes home and shows his wife, you know, 200 rupees. So she says, you must have done something illegal. He said, no, I just sold the goat. So his wife says, that old goat couldn't have fetched you, you know, 200 rupees. And sure enough, you know, the goats come grazing back home because they know their way home. And in the meanwhile, the American has loaded the statue, you know, onto a passing truck and siphoned some diesel for his petrol for his car. And he's talking about it to his to these guys and says, you know what, this will sit in my, you know, atrium in my Manhattan penthouse, this beautiful statue of this man on a horse. So, I mean, this is a story of colossal misunderstanding, you know. And, you know, where I think I brought it up partly because Emily G said that it's a matter of conversation. It's a matter of, you know, communicating with one another. And he's buying something that doesn't belong to the person from whom he's buying it. And I think a lot of the loot and plunder of artifacts all over the world, you know, is presented in this metaphorical manner in the story. So your last words, Anuragji.
Well, you know, I'm going to start off where you left off, from a fictional story to a real story. You know, and this is not me participating in the outrage Olympics at all. You know, back in 1968, Wendy Doniger, who now heads the Asian Studies program or whatever it's called at Harvard. So she's written about her travels through India and a whole bunch of faith objects, which she essentially took from here and took it back with her, and how they adorn her home now and all of that. So we're not talking about a fictional story. We're not talking about R.K. Narayan here. We are talking about having conversations with people who consider it absolutely legit to pick up what they like, take it back home, and guess what? They actually go on later in their lives to lead South Asian Studies program and represent our voice at their universities. And that's something which we should be kind of worried about. You know, going back to the other question, and I couldn't agree with you more. You know, these are very complex issues between the 20, 50, whatever number of people we have on this call. We will have multiple opinions, right? What is the core principles? How do you deal with exceptions to those principles? Who signs off on those principles? You know, is it a community? Is it a government? Is it an own? So it's not going to be easy at all. We're really talking about a conversation about reframing morality, right? So to me, it is no different from, let's say, a conversation on whether dowry should be banned. It's a conversation on whether, you know, African-Americans get to use the same toilets and the same bus. You know, it's about, you know, women's suffrage. None of these conversations are easy. I mean, you will have a lot of men that said women should not be allowed to vote. You'd have a lot of women that said they don't want to vote. So we'll have a lot of opinions which will need to be sorted out, and it's going to be complex. It's going to be push and pull. Now, just because an ideal answer doesn't exist, doesn't mean you should live with something you know is wrong. And that's a larger principle, which, you know, that's a larger thought I'd like to leave you guys with, which is to say that, hey, should we live with something that we know is fundamentally amoral, unethical, illegal, in today's context? Perhaps it was legal then, just as it was, I don't know, it was legitimate to beat up your wife at some point of time, but today you won't think of it. Is it okay for us to live with something that we know today is immoral? Just because a wounded, violent worldview said it was legitimate back then. And is it okay to take the lack of an ideal solution as a good enough excuse to live with something that we know is wrong? And that's, you know, so while we sort the ideal solution out, we need to stop looking, we need to stop living with something we know is wrong to begin with. With that as the core principle of at least how I view this, again, I'd like to thank you, Makaranji. This is fascinating. I mean, you know, what's interesting about conversations with you is you always walk away thinking about whatever belief system you came into the conversation with. And I think, you know, that's how growth, that's how development happens. So I'm really thankful that, I'm really thankful to you. I'm thankful to all the four people who had those questions. I'm thankful, of course, to Emily, who's here, and to everybody else who's watching. I'm sure going forward, we'll start building those partnerships that you talked about. We'll start having those conversations. We'll start mainstreaming this. It is time for the world to sign up to doing the right thing on this issue. And finally, India is at a place where we can kind of nudge this conversation. So I'm very glad that we've started having it. Thank you. That's back to you, sir.
That's wonderful. I was just going to say that one place to actually target is Purvis Castle on the border of England and Wales, which contains, possibly the most astonishing collection of, you know, Indian loot in England. Much of it traced back to, you know, Lord Robert Clive, you know, one of the greatest plunderers, I think also a military genius, but Purvis Castle should be in our crosshairs. But what about the charity? I thought you were going to make a little pitch about that.
Oh, well, yes. Just as an FYI, not forcing anybody to it. So I've been supporting this charity, for a long time, called Vanvasi Kalyan Ashram. Vanvasi, as you all know, I find the term a little pejorative, but you know, we'll stick with it. Vanvasi literally means forest people. There's a whole bunch of tribals who've been, because of multiple reasons, who are disassociated from mainstream society. They do not have access to the kind of medicines, education, facilities, etc., that you and I take for granted. It's almost a century old, and what I do is, which I'm doing for today's meeting as well, I'm donating the whole honorarium that you're kindly giving me to the Vanvasi Kalyan Ashram. A bunch of us have been doing it for a while. Very interestingly, the Prime Minister this year awarded a Padma Award to the founder of the Vanvasi Kalyan Ashram. So I'm personally very, very glad that happened. I'm a big fan. Look, very often when you mainstream a community, you almost inflict an atrocity of another sort, right? Where you force them to lose their sense of identity and adapt yours. What I like about the Vanvasi Kalyan Ashram is that they don't interfere with your sense of identity. They're only there to help. They've done an amazing job. I mean, 2,800 villages, thousands of projects over the year. Even a 100 rupee contribution to them is accounted for, and you're told what that money is being spent on. It's fascinating. I mean, they can stretch a dollar really, really far. So, you know, I'm very happy to support them. And would urge any of you who pledge to giving to consider adding the Vanvasi Kalyan Ashram to your list of beneficiaries if you could.
Thank you so much, Anuragji. I do hope, wish and pray that a Padma Award comes your way as well. I will publicly state that I'll be happy to nominate you or support you. I mean, the process is very transparent, and I think you deserve it very much for the work you've done. And I respect you as an individual. I have affection for you as a friend. And thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you so much.
My pleasure was all mine, Mukherjee. Namaste, and let's go Jai Hind before we go.
Jai Hind.
Jai Hind.
Thank you all.